Hey guys, Sam Pardee here, and I'm going to be recording some modern for ChannelFireball.com, and I'm going to be playing with the Whir prison deck that I played to a really atrocious X4 and 2 record at Grand Prix Tampa, which was very frustrating. Nevertheless, the deck felt very powerful. I think it's quite good against Phoenix, Dredge, and Death Shadow, which I think, you know, are sort of the three big decks in the format, and then it has game against just about everyone else. If people are weak to Ensnaring Bridge, I think this deck is pretty effective at beating them. The basic function of the deck is as either a Chalice of the Void or Ensnaring Bridge, often both deck. So you play a lot of zero-cost artifacts to try to enable turn one Mox Opal, and then, you know, you can play a Chalice off that. The other thing you do is you have War of Invention, you have Ensnaring Bridge, and you have a lot of Welding Jars, so a lot of people are completely unable to defend themselves against that, at least in game one. And then in the post-board games, you pivot a little bit. You typically board in either Psy or Tezzeret, maybe both, and try to kill people with actual cards that deal damage, and usually that's pretty effective. One of the cards that is particularly scary against this deck is Shatterstorm, which is why there's two unmoored egos in the sideboard. It hits Shatterstorm, hits Amulet decks are playing cards like Tragic Arrogance or Consulate Crackdown that you can get rid of. You know, there's a lot of cards that are pretty good against you that people have been starting to add to their sideboards. And I think that's one of the big things about this deck is it's very good when you know exactly what your opponent's up to. You have to watch out when you maybe don't. When you don't have a great idea of exactly all the cards in their deck, that's when things get the most scary, because you have a lot of cards like Sorcerer's Spyglass, Chalice of the Void, that need to be set to the correct things and the correct numbers to know what you're doing. So I would say this is an expert level deck that you really should only play if you feel like you are pretty comfortable with knowing the latest trends in modern, but it is quite powerful if you're up for that. The win condition, which almost never comes up, usually people just concede once they're locked with like Chalice and Ensnaring Bridge, is either Pyrite Spellbomb, recurred by Academy Ruins, or Ipnu Rivulet, recurred by Crucible of Worlds. They both work just fine. Winning the game can be a problem. At the Grand Prix, I got two draws in matches that I was, I had game three as a hard lock, but the games just took a really long time because I couldn't find a way to win the game quickly enough. So you got to watch out for that. I would recommend playing very quickly. And so yeah, that's the deck. Let's get to some games. All right, here we are for round one. We are on the draw, and I think we're going to throw this one back. Triple Whir is just so clunky. It really clogs up your hand. This hand looks okay. Botanical Sanctum. I think we can do better. I think between Bauble and Stirrings, we're very likely, if we need to find a land, to find it. And I would rather, try to find a bridge or a chalice. I think that's really sort of the thing you should be looking towards getting into play, is one of those two cards in most matchups is really where you want to be. Basic Island Pass. Okay. Don't know what to make of that. I kind of want to not play Stirrings this turn because I really don't know what I'm looking for. I'm just going to play my two artifacts and pass, because we can play Spyglass Stirrings next turn and hopefully have a better idea. You know, there's a lot of different things our opponent could be playing, like Storm, Phoenix, all seem pretty reasonable. And, maybe we'll have a better idea next turn of what kind of card we need. All right, so it looks like it's blue-white control. And we will go ahead and take a quick look-see, see what we can see. The blue-white control is a pretty rough matchup. Almost any deck that uses Cryptic Command is usually pretty hard to beat. The way that we try to do it is to get them locked under Crucible Tech Edge and have a bunch of Spyglasses locking out their Planeswalkers. That's what I found to be the most effective strategy. Chalice. Chalice is not particularly good against them. So we'll just go ahead and stir, see what we can find. Another bauble or a tech edge. I think we should just take the tech edge. I was gonna transmute Teleria West for it probably, but now we can just grab it. I suppose we'll just play it and pass. And now the Teleria West can become probably an Inventor's Fair, with the eye of ultimately turning it into a Crucible. And then you have Crucible Inventor's Fair, which is a really powerful combo, actually. This going to be a Jace? Yeah, I thought it might. Jace is quite a good card and very hard for us to beat. We've already used one of our spyglasses. I think I am going to go ahead and tech edge here. I guess I don't really care about any of their white cards, so we'll just go after Field of Ruin because it's actually more annoying for us. And it ultimately turns into a basic. That's not great. All right, Teleria West is going to become an Inventor's Fair. Yeah, this is going to be really tough from here. If they get to untap with counter magic, the game becomes pretty much an uphill battle. Possible I shouldn't have run out the stirrings on turn, or the Sorcerer's Spyglass on turn two, once I realized the matchup, because it's a pretty important card. Maybe should have just played stirrings instead and, tried to get to a turn where we could play multiple important spells. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and play Chalice for two, which locks out Mana Leak and Snapcaster. I didn't really think there was much chance of that working. Draw. We'll concede if they play like a Teferi here or something. I think that'll do it. Postboard, we do get a little more card, card selection that's actually powerful. Like we get to bring in some size and cut a lot of our cards that are completely dead. Oof. Field of Ruin takes out Inventor's Fair. Yeah, Relic actually is just game here, I think. We can't really beat that. Surprised to see it in the main deck. It's not bad. Not bad at all. All right. Oh yeah, we have Unmoored Ego now in our sideboard too. That's actually pretty good. So we're gonna bring in these, this, cut the Witchbane Orb, cut the Damping Sphere. I think cut one EE. I think EE is just okay. Same for Welding Jar. It's like not that good. They usually don't have that many cards that outright destroy your things. More spyglasses. We can cut way down on Ensnaring Bridge down to like one or two. I think down to just one is fine. Bottled Cloister is also pretty risky and not necessary. Yeah, this looks pretty good. Not sure exactly about. Maybe one Spellskite is okay. The Pirate Spell Bombs doesn't really do very much. I think it's fine to cut. And yeah, not sure about Chalice. I think it's just okay against them, not great. It does fit pretty well into the plan of Tech Edge locking them, because once you do that, then Chalice on, one and two and three can actually start to really put a damper on their game plan. All right, let's give this a try. Right, here we are on the play. This hand's pretty nice. I'm definitely happy to keep this. Psy is a solid angle, and even if they have a path for the first one, we've got a backup, and we have a Welding Jar we can play immediately following it. Fire off a Spire here. Prefer to keep the Tech Edge and the Academy Ruins hidden from any Field of Ruins for as long as possible. Ooh, all right, another zero drop. That's pretty nice. Jam this guy. All right, well, that went much better than I would have thought. I kind of thought he was going to at least get path on the first artifact. And then I think we should just go ahead and crack Mishra's Bauble here, maybe during their upkeep. Just want more cards. Another blue. Oh, there's the path. Another blue source would let us cast Whir for two, which is pretty nice. Or even three, actually, if we want. Yep, size a goner. So, looks like we can go land, Psy, Opal, and then still have Whir available, which is pretty sweet. Think we just attack with one Thopter so we can still Whir for three, because it looks like, yeah, I think being able to get Crucible here would could be potentially very valuable, or maybe like a Spyglass in response to a Jace or something. Okay, so they are going for a Field of Ruin. I'm gonna respond now with our Whir and go pick up that that coveted Crucible of Worlds. Talisman of Progress. So one thing we can do here now is I think it's good to just draw Mishra's Bauble. We have all of our mana kind of accounted for, and Mishra's Bauble just seems like one of the best cards we could draw. It cantrips anyway, so that's fine. And it gives us a free Thopter basically. And then I think we just go ahead and smash with everybody. And now we could go ahead and Whir for a Spyglass right now, but I don't think that's a good thing to do. I think we should wait. Just wait until they actually put a Planeswalker on the stack. We have a plenty good clock at this point. It's nice that if our opponent wants to continue to develop their mana base, they're almost obligated to just fire off these Field of Ruins every time they draw them right away. Yeah, this is fine. We don't have any islands left to get, but what can you do? So now, yeah, now we could go and pick up that Spyglass, but I think it's better to just untap. Oh shoot, I should have used Mishra's Bauble. I meant to do that. Oh well, no punishment. So I think we should sack Opal and Welding Jar here to draw a card. The Welding Jar doesn't really do much. Pretty unlikely they have disenchant, and we have a new Opal to replace anyway. And another Whir. It's gonna be a Vendilion click, maybe. Thirst for Knowledge. Okay, haven't seen that one in a while. That's cool. I guess that's works well with the talismans. That's sweet. So now the door is definitely open for us to Whir if we want to. I just, again, really don't know what we would get. And it seems like a Wrath is one of their better ways out, and actually just getting to sack two Thopters when that happens would be pretty nice. I think now I will end of turn Whir for Spyglass just to see what's up. Cataclysmic Gearhulk. Holy moly. So we get to keep Psy and Crucible, I guess, and we're going to lose everything else. So we should. I guess we should sack. Maybe we should bobble ourselves so we can decide what we want to do. No, because we're going to draw a bunch of cards. Because we're going to sack all these Thopters. Yeah, let's bobble them. Take a little look-see. Opt. Okay. Okay, Tezzeret's pretty good. Guess we probably are not playing it this turn. Tormod's Crypt, just a little mana leak insurance. So we'll keep that creature and that artifact. And we could put Opal back. I guess we can just play Tezzeret, maybe. Seems relatively safe. We have another one anyway. Nice. Let's go ahead and take a look at what we can pick up here. Snaring Bridge. I think just. Well, Spellscout actually seems pretty good. Protects our Psy. And they may have Cryptic Command here to like tap our team and then they can attack Tezzeret. It seems like the most likely way that Tezzeret dies, but even if that happens, we can just slam the other Tezzeret minus one on Spellskite, and that's 9 points of power. So I think that's fine. Cataclysmic Gearhulk, boy. People have been really stepping up their game with this style of effect in Modern lately. I've seen amulet lists that have been running with the oh, what's the name of that card? Tragic Arrogance as a way to beat this deck, and I think it's pretty effective. I think Cataclysmic Gearhulk is a lot worse because I get to pick the things that I want to live, so I get to keep my Psy instead of losing down to just a Thopter. But it's definitely cute. I'm gonna play Relic, pop it right away. I don't really see where this is all headed, because unless they can do something about Tezzeret, they're just gonna die. We're gonna ultimate it for, just a billion damage. I didn't even realize this thing had vigilance. Well, you learn something new every day. All right, let's see what you got on top over there. A negate. So I think I am going to go ahead and Whir for two. Just to make sure that there's, nothing going on over there that can really mess us up with a Spyglass. Yeah, none of those cards do anything. I'll name Abandoned Reason. And kaboom. All right. Well, our sideboard plan worked out pretty well there. I guess the Crucible, had some impact. Our opponent was stranded with two lands left in their hand at the end of the game and didn't have Cryptic Command mana. They could have played the Hallowed Fountain and had Cryptic Command mana that turn, but definitely didn't do nothing. So I think I'm gonna bring in Torpor Orb. It seems good enough to me. Haven't seen a Snapcaster Mage yet. Which kind of makes me want to board out Tormod's Crypt. And Chalice does look pretty darn medium. could see cutting one. Cut it for like a pyrite spell bomb, which at least cycles. Yep. All right. This looks fine. I could see you having two bridges also. Nah, just one is good. All right. Let's give this a try. All right. Here we are for game three. This hand, again, looks really, really good to me. We have double Psy, which is, I think, exactly what we want in the matchup. It seemed really good in that last game, and hopefully it'll be really good again this game. Now, we're going to have an interesting decision where we could try to turn two a Psy, or just chill and, you know, play it on turn three with three zero-cost things to do. I think because we have the Chalice, it's pretty likely we end up playing it on turn three instead. Oh, wow. They're tapped so low. Oh, well, all right, let's get some information. That sounds better. Snapcaster, Jace, Flooded Strand, and Field of Ruin. Okay. Yeah, I guess we're just naming Jace. And I think we should go ahead and cycle off one bobble just to get us some additional intel. So we're going to do this during their upkeep, because they could run Vendilion Click, and they could main phase Vendilion Click. You never know. Another Relic. Darn, kind of wish we'd named Relic now. That would have been sweet. Well, if we draw a land, we're in pretty darn good shape, I think. With Jace shut off and just an opt available to them, they'll have to cycle through the Relics pretty quickly. Played Flooded Strand. We did not draw a land. So. We could play Opal Jar pass with the plan of Whirring. Kind of like that. That shuts off all their relics. Does make our Psy a lot worse, but I think Psy will end up being good eventually anyway. So let's just do that, yeah. We'll let him Snapcaster and opt. Left the card on top. Alright, well, let's see what another Spyglass finds out. A Dispel. Perfect. Good thing we did things in the order we did them. Are they going to bother to cast a Jace here? Or are they just going for Field of Ruin, maybe? Alright, well, let's get the party started with Ancient Stirrings. Finds just a whole mess of options. Crucible sounds like the best one. And I think we'll still just go ahead and play Psy this turn, though. Pretty greedy, but greed is good sometimes. Sure. Not a problem at all. Psy is back again, and I think we do actually want to go ahead and get a Chalice on one here. Shuts out Path. And the Dispel we know about as well. So, definitely not for nothing. Let's go ahead and play this Crucible. Pick up this Botanical Sanctum. Oh, maybe the Crucible's not resolving. Okay. Well, we've got our Thopter. So they still have just the three cards that we know about in hand there. Alright, now they can start activating colonnades. Oh, but they played their thing tapped, so they can't. Alright, they're just casting a Jace. I think we should just go ahead and kill Jace, and we'll play a Spyglass on Colonnade. Like, I think this gives us some protection from Cryptic Command being a super good draw. Yeah, I think it's just pretty safe to do. They find another Wrath. They found the Gear Hulk. Uh-oh. Or is this just Teferi? Teferi would be very beatable. No? What is it? Nothing? Okay. And we have 5 points a turn as our clock, so we don't really need to do anything. I think we should just chill for a while. Don't really have a number for Chalice right now. 5 would be what I would want it on, but yeah, I'll just chill. Yeah, I'm just gonna pass because they've shown that they've boarded in Wrath. They do have Snapcaster, so they could maybe Snapcaster Wrath. I guess we could have played Chalice on 2 to play around that, but... Alright, well, Psy is a busted card, and looks like he has carried us to a victory. We'll be back for the next round. Alright, here we are for round 3. We get to go first. Yes, this is a good hand. I will keep it. We have Chalice on 1 on turn 1, which is basically just good enough to keep, I think, for the most part. Obviously, there are going to be some matchups where this hand is the pits, but hopefully this isn't one of them. We also have a Damping Sphere to follow up with, so, you know, if they're, like, Amulet or something, it's actually kind of good. Chalice on 1. And then I guess we should go ahead and crack... I like that. We'll go ahead and crack a Bauble during their upkeep. Maybe both, we'll see. So, they had a Street Wraith. Okay, so they're playing Death Shadow. Yeah, Chalice on 1 is really good against Death Shadow. Makes it pretty tough for them to do much in the games, usually. I think we should probably go ahead and crack the other Bauble. Oh! They're playing a more sophisticated Death Shadow deck. The kind with Tarmogoyfs in it. That makes the Chalice on 1 a little less effective, but still very good. So yeah, let's go ahead and take another look, I guess. Thought Seize, that's not going to do much. Alright, well, we're well on our way to Chalice on 2. Guess I'm fine with playing Damping Sphere. It doesn't really seem like it does anything, but it's in fact likely to hurt us. But whatever. We do ultimately want to empty our hand. So they might be able to sneak in a little Tarmogoyf here. Seems like the most problematic thing they could do. Yeah, there is the troublesome Lurgoyf. We'll go ahead and Chalice on Deuce. Now really just have to find an Ensnaring Bridge, and it's going to be a race between the Tarmogoyf and us finding Ensnaring Bridge. Fortunately, our deck has a lot of ways to do it. We have, you know, we have 4 Whirs, 4 Bridges. Obviously, our Ancient Stirrings are shut off, but we also have a perfectly fine solution in Transmuting Teleria West for Inventor's Fair. Like, it's slow, but our opponent's clock is also really slow in this case. And I believe they, maybe they have some instants they're gonna cast or something. Sure. And I guess they couldn't cast that and the Thoughtseize because of the Damping Sphere, so it actually saved us a life. And there's the bridge. The old Bridgerino. Hopefully that's just game. Yeah, that's just game. This matchup is very good. They have a lot of hand disruption, but if you ever stick a bridge, the game is just over immediately. So I think Spellskite's pretty great against them. I don't want Spyglass, I want the Spellskites. All the Spellskites in, all this stuff out. We could leave in one Spyglass. I sometimes have like Liliana's. Witchbane Orb I think is not very good. EE I think is pretty good. Crucible is an interesting card. I tend to go back and forth on it. It's just pretty good in this deck. Like, I think it just works really well with our core game plan. So it's kind of tough to want to cut it a lot. But it's not great in this matchup. We're boarding out the Tech Edge because it definitely, you know, we don't really care about moving our opponent from four lands to three, and it's just not that good. It doesn't tap to cast Whir of Invention. So Crucible, I think, is a highly questionable card that I'm really not sure what we're supposed to do with. I think, yeah, EE's good. Tormod's Crypt is, I think, medium. Pyrite Spellbomb's kind of not good. Psy is better. I think I'm gonna sideboard like this. I'm gonna cut the Crucible actually and bring in one of these Tezzerets. And yeah, I'm not confident in zero Spyglass. This could be a recipe for getting owned by Liliana. But we do have Engineered Explosives in our deck that can kill it, and you know, hopefully we can slow them down a lot. Yeah, all right, let's give this a try. All right, here we are for game two. We're on the draw. This hand is pretty horrible. Doesn't do anything until a really late turn, and then we still don't get to do anything because we only have Whirs. All right, this hand looks fine. We'll keep this. And our opponent's on the mold of five. Seems fortunate for us. Yeah, definitely put that one right on top. That's a good place for it. Right where a hand disruption spell can't necessarily find it. Let's go ahead and stir. I like Welding Jar. And I'm actually going to play the Jar and the Opal. I don't want to lose them to hand disruption effects. I think they're actually going to be pretty good. And our opponent didn't fetch a black source, so they can't Thoughtseize us now. And they don't have a second land, it looks like. Okay, well. I guess, I mean, they did mold a five, so it makes sense that, you know, they wouldn't have all the goods. Okay. We will block the Nacatl card. Don't really care if we lose Spellskite to a Lightning Bolt, it's not that big a deal. I would not use Welding Jar on it because I think that could be more valuable to do later. Oh, well, okay. That one I'll go ahead and steal. They have like a Fatal Push now or something. I guess they just have to do that or they lose their Nacatl. That didn't seem like it worked out exactly as planned, I would guess. There's a Death Shadow. Here's an Ensnaring Bridge. And we're pretty insulated. Okay, well, we were pretty insulated from Teemo Battle Rage there because we had the Spellskite and we had the Welding Jar to protect. So I don't really know how we could have lost that game. And it looks like neither did our opponent. So we will be back for round number three shortly. All right, here we are for round three. This hand is clearly no bueno. This one is not great. Two four drops is pretty rough. There's a reason the curve is so low usually. Oh boy. Yeah, I guess we're supposed to keep this. turn three bridge is usually still pretty good, even. Oh, now we're playing a mirror. Oh, Jesus. Well, gross. Bridge does nothing, in fact, in the mirror. Witchbane Orb is good, though. Witchbane Orb is nice. So that's cool. The way that these mirrors go is somebody gets decked, and all the stuff ends up locked out at a certain point. So we're definitely never putting this Bottled Cloister into play. There's no way they can deal damage to us. Bottled Cloister does not do anything. We're just gonna be. Oh, okay, it's Amulet. Oh, okay, we're fine then. Never mind. Disregard everything I said. It's all lies. Then the Ensnaring Bridge is actually fine. Okay. Yep. We'll go ahead and bobble. See what we can see. A Pact of Negation. That one stayed on the top, eh? So they have a Prime Time. Colony Garden. So nothing much going on over there. If we name Sakura Tribe Scout, they won't be able to Pact of Negation or Ensnaring Bridge. It looks like they're on the canister version of this deck, which means they do not have access to Engineered Explosives in game one, probably. They don't play Engineered Explosives or Walking Ballista. Which means the main way we end up losing, I think, is to a Colony Garden token being pumped by Primeval or by Slayer's Stronghold, and then maybe doubled with Sun Home. So it's possible that if we just name Slayer's Stronghold, they're completely hardlocked, from what I remember in Canister's list. If they've deviated, of course, we could lose. So it's a little bit risky. And normally I think you want to name Sakura Tribe Scout because what you end up doing is getting a Ensnaring Bridge, Tectonic Edge thing going so you can kill off their Colony Garden tokens and they can break that up with Sakura Tribe Scout by putting a Karu land into play and picking up their important lands. but I think because Canister's list is so different, we actually are just supposed to name Slayer's Stronghold. Right, and then let's. Oh, well, I guess. Then they get to play Gruul Turf, pick up Botanical Sanctum, put it into play. Yeah, they're still short. This is pretty interesting. I'm gonna just name Sakura Tribe Scout. This might be like hard mode, and I think it kind of is, but it's not. I think it's just better safe than sorry here. It's not likely that we lose to much of anything. So there's the Gruul Turf. Gonna pick up the Botanical Sanctum. Because we do have the Inventor's Fair already, which makes it pretty darn likely that we're able to set up the full lock before this Colony Garden thing comes to get us. So they're going to play the Korelic as expected. Beat down a little bit. There's the Sanctum that we knew about back. And now they can use Pact of Negation because they have that all going on. But it's not that big of a deal to get our Bottled Cloister pacted. So yeah, if they want to, they can. We can win without it. It will be very good to have in play, though. It'll give us a lot of extra business. They declined to pack there because I think they're just valuing getting Primeval Titan down higher than that. And we already have the tech edge, so if we ever can manage to get the if we ever can manage to get the Slayer Stronghold into the graveyard, I think we just have the check mark. Again, not 100% sure because I'm not positive on how this deck is constructed. I would, you know, it would be nice to get like the insurance spyglass on engineered explosives or something, just in case. But yeah, I think we're safe. All right, so there's a Botanical Sanctum. That is good to let us whir for Spyglass if we want to. Let's just do that. It's probably going to get countered anyway, but it's worth a shot. Oh, okay, it didn't. All right, well, I think we just have it now. Oh, no, I should have... Oh, I was supposed to name Zakama. He was playing Zakama. Oh, gosh. Oh, no, I've really screwed things up. That's the thing that you're supposed to name. I totally forgot. Oh, my goodness. Well then. Zakama will really mess us up if it comes into play. And it's coming. Oh my goodness. And they have the Pact of Negation. Oh, that's so bad. I just totally forgot. And we could have just gotten Torpor Orb. Or not Torpor Orb, the other one. Damping Sphere. Jesus. Yeah, this was really bad. And just totally unnecessary, too. Alright, Welding Jar it is for now. So one thing we can do is try and mill over that stupid Zakama. Just mill them twice. I guess I could also actually blow up two Karus. That'll leave us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 mana. Yeah, actually, let's just do that. That's actually... Whew, well, I have made this game much harder than it needed to be. Oh, I don't even have a Crucible in play. My goodness. This is a fine mess I've made. Alright, well. Let's do all the things. Maybe this will force some pact action. Did not mill over Zakama. So they're going to be able to play it next turn. They're going to be able to kill three things with it. Well, I'll just wait and see it. Gosh, I feel so dumb. I mean, and this is exactly the kind of thing you need to be really careful about when you play a deck like this, is you need to be darn sure that you know the format. Because, you know, some lists play... plays a comma, some lists play engineered explosives, and it's a huge difference as to which it is. You know, it matters a lot in the context of the game. I also just thought I already had a Crucible in play, but I guess that was just some scatterbrained thinking on my part. Okay, they're going for another Primeval Titan first. Okay, well, given that I don't know how we could possibly win anyway, this doesn't really bother me. Yeah, so, you know, I figured out that it was the canister list because I saw the Serum Visions there, which is not a card that is played really outside of his list, and Botanical Sanctum also. So, you know, I had that all locked up and decided, and then I just forgot about this card that was in their deck, so we're gonna lose. But yeah, just, you know, it really matters. Oh, okay, wait, maybe I'm wrong. That card wasn't in Canister's list. Maybe there is no Zakama waiting in the wings here. I mean, I'm still going to lose to that, don't get me wrong. But That's really interesting. I don't think we have any outs to it because they can go Summoner's Pact and then Pact of Negation Forces to Pact of Negation it. Yeah, that'll do it. If I hadn't spewed off all these lands trying to mill over Zakama, we'd have two more in play, which would give us five, six, seven. Still not enough, but. Huh. Well. Yeah, I don't know what we can do about this. Think the answer is just nothing. This doesn't target or anything. It's really funny. If I hadn't used the Ipni Rivulet, we would just see this with the bauble, and I could mill it now, and that would be that. That is how the whole thing works, right? They're gonna play the pact. Force us to copy it, let our copy resolve, then they play the Pact of Negation. I guess I'll just make them do it. I mean, I don't know. Gosh, well. Yeah, so I just completely wasted that Sorcerer's Spyglass. Could have been anything else and it would have been better. That's really bad. If it had been Crucible, that would have been good enough because we'd have the Ipni Rivulet going, and we could stop this hive mind from happening to us. If it had been, you know, a damping sphere, that would also be pretty good because they would have not nearly as much mana, although probably still enough to kill us. So we're gonna transmute the other Teleri West they have and pick up another pact. Yeah, we really can't win. All right, we're dead. We're dead. I give. Whew. Well, that is one big oops from me. So we're gonna board out Witchbane Orb, we're gonna board in Unmoored Ego, we're gonna board out Pyrite Spellbomb, we're gonna board out Tormod's Crypt. I think Chalice is like pretty mediocre, but probably still worth keeping in some numbers. Engineered Explosives is super medium, so I'm gonna cut way down on those. Crucible's great. I don't think Spellskite is particularly good. It does stop some of the Titan stuff. Like, it stops them from being able to target with Slayer Stronghold, but I think if that is the point at which the game is getting to, it's not very good for you anyway. Spyglass, I think, is actually pretty good. And then Tezzeret, I think, is also pretty good. We have to cut a little bit more. See cutting a jar, although jar enables some faster chalice hands and things like that. So I'm usually pretty loath to cut a jar, but I think it's probably the right thing to do here. All right, here we go. New game, new mindset. Not gonna let that carry over from the previous game. We're just gonna win. All right, here we are for game two. We get to go first. This is a mediocre hand, but I'm still gonna keep it. Bridge into Cloister is just pretty nice to have, even though it's not great. And I'm gonna play EE for one, actually, to start. That way we can deal with an amulet. And we'll go ahead and bobble. I think we do actually just want the extra cards here, so we'll bobble them. Take a look. Summoner's Pact. Okay. So that means that Teleri West might want to get transmuted for Chalice, depending on if we end up needing it for mana. And if you've enjoyed this video of me, you know, really bungling around in in Modern, really making a fine mess of things. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe, and consider buying some sweet cards from ChannelFireball.com. They got a lot of good stuff, and yeah, it's a good site. So, packed, Azusa, Stirring, Serum Vision, Simic Growth Chamber, Amulet of Vigor. They did not play, well, they couldn't play the amulet anyway, but they probably weren't going to play it into the EE. And should I name Zakama? Do they have Zakama post-board? Probably not. I think if they don't have it in game one, they probably don't have it in the sideboard. What is the best thing to name? This is a tough spot. They almost certainly do have engineered explosives post-board. That part is at least very likely, but I don't want to shut off our own engineered explosives right now. Later in the game, fine, not a problem. But right now, I'd prefer not to. Yeah, I think I'm just gonna go ahead and name Slayer Stronghold. Yeah, Slayer Stronghold. Very low confidence in that decision, but it does shut off one of their paths to victory. And they drew a Botanical Sanctum, so they can play Stirrings, which finds a Boros Garrison, and they can play Serum Visions. And they put two on the bottom. All right. Definitely going to play this Teleria West. So now they're going to get to play Azusa because they're going to go Amulet, and then we will get to destroy it, but they don't have to pass priority. They get to immediately play a Bounce Land, which lets them, which lets the Amulet do its thing. So one thing we can do here. Oops, I should pop this now. One thing that we can do here is transmute Teleria West for Chalice and play it for zero. I think that's pretty reasonable. Probably forces them to use Summoner's Pack now. I forgot to board Entorpor Orb, didn't I? Boy, oh boy. I really let that last game do a number on me. Okay, so one of the cards they drew is Bajuka Bog, which means we don't know the entire contents of their hand. Oh no, we do, because there's a Teleria West as the last card. Oh yeah, they played the Simic Growth Chamber. Okay, makes sense. So they have Bajuka Bog and Teleria West as their two other remaining cards. So yeah, if we transmute Teleria West for Chalice, play it for zero, that will shut them off. They'll have to use a pact now. And then they will have to pay for it on their next turn, and that'll stop them from jamming a Titan, which has some value. So let's do that. And then next turn we can go Crucible, replay Teleria West, which is always nice. Oh, okay. They can't play that this turn still. But that might be pretty good, actually. Oh no, they have Bajuka Bog. They can get rid of our Teleria West, so we're not gonna get to replay it. They're gonna replay the they're gonna play the Boros Garrison, pick up that one, presumably play it and Bajuka Bog. Or maybe not. Maybe they're gonna save the Botanical Sanctum. Yeah, it looks like they are. Fair enough. Yeah, I think it's better to just get bridge down here. Our opponent is going to get to draw a whole mess of cards, that's for sure. Looks like they might be low on lands and don't want to replay the Teleria West that they have in their hand. Alright, I'll play Bottled Cloister. Hopefully we don't just die to some pact shenanigans. Didn't play the Welding Dryer there because we have Chalice on zero. Don't wanna lose it there. But I guess maybe they can transmute for Engineered Explosives. We'll see. We'll see what their Teleria West goes and picks up. A Ghost Quarter. Okay, that's not really a problem. We have Crucible. We are gonna ultimately need to find the... Oh, they already had the EE. No, they have Ramming Up Excavator. Okay, well then this is a problem. And our Engineered Explosives is exiled, so I don't actually think we can win anymore. I believe. Yeah, I think we're just locked out. Boy. Alright, well. Those games were instructive. Really, I would say, you know, be careful about what you're doing. This game is tough. We will be back for round number 4 and play it better, hopefully. Alright, here we are for round number 4. We get to go first. This is a medium hand, but I'm going to keep it. It's tough to mulligan basically any hand with bridge, even one as truly mediocre as this one. The question is, if we're supposed to stir on turn 1 or play Teleria West on turn 1, I think... Both have a lot of merit, and I think I'm going to go with Stirrings. There's a chance we end up never having to use the lands, or never having to play the Teleria West, and we get to actually transmute it, which would be really nice. I'm just going to take Spire here. I think our hand just needs lands for the most part. If we don't draw a land next turn, I am just going to play Teleria West. Basic Island. Don't know what that's all about. Hopefully I'll find out soon. So... yeah, I'm going to play the Teleria West now. No need to play the Opal, I guess. Okay, looks like Phoenix. That's fine. We have Bridge pretty quickly against them. That's really all that you need. A little Pyromancer Ascension insurance never hurt anyone, but usually just the bridge is at least close to good enough. Didn't really have a reason for playing the Opal, but I didn't have a reason to not play it either. So now we could play Damping Sphere and then Whir for 2. I don't even know what that gets. We could also just play bridge, play Damping Sphere. I think the... Yeah, I really don't even know what we would get. Again, the most likely way that we lose, I think, does involve Pyromancer's Ascension. I guess I like playing the Damping Sphere here. And then we can go ahead and Whir for, I think, just Tormod's Crypt. And try to use that to control a Pyromancer Ascension, even though that's like a little bit of an uphill battle. Yeah, I think that should be fine. May as well play this for two to look like we're up to something. And yeah, I'm just going to pick up Tormod's Crypt. Obviously, we don't even have to use it until a Pyromancer Ascension comes into play, but it's not bad to have in your back pocket. Oh. Okay. Kind of an unusual choice in the in this deck. I'm going to go ahead and Whir for the... Go ahead and pick up the Bottled Cloister. I guess maybe the Witchbane Orb completes the lock, so we should just wait on that. Like, we could have just passed, and then if they take the Witchbane Orb, we play it, and... Oh, okay. So they must have some out to Ensnaring Bridge, given that they took away the other one. It seems like something else is going on here. They must have, like, Cryptic Command in their deck or something. Yeah, this ain't no normal Phoenix deck. This is definitely a deck playing with Cryptic Command. Kind of regretting this Tormod's Crypt now that we have seen a little more. But too late for that now. Oh, right. There's a stupid... Damping Sphere in play. Alright, well, I'm just going to play Witchbane Orb then. Use the most of my mana. Ideally, we want to play this Chalice for X equals 4. So, we'll work towards that. I'm going to go ahead and bobble them. See what we can see. Yeah, there's a Cryptic Command. No doubt about that. Luckily, it still doesn't actually do that much. It just hits us for 10. So it's not the end of the world, because we have plenty of life to work with. But that does mean that we should put some amount of priority on getting additional Ensnaring Bridges into play. Or at least, like, EEing away these stupid thing in the ices. Wouldn't mind killing our own Damping Sphere either. Okay, there's the other bridge. That should be good to have. Yeah, okay. At least this removes the Vendilion Click from play. And we do get to try again later. Then I guess we stir and hope to hit a land. Yeah, there's a land. I guess Tech Edge is fine. Okay, so they're just going after the bridge now. And just gonna get us for 7, I guess. That doesn't seem so bad. One thing they could have done there was get our bottled cloister, and then we lose all the cards under it, which could have been devastating. But here's two bridges, so maybe this will keep us safe. And then we do get to jam Chalice on four next turn. So this is definitely a harder matchup for us than Phoenix. Cryptic Command's a really good card in their deck. But they probably have much fewer cantrips, so it's gonna be much easier in the post-board games for that reason. All right, Inventor's Fair. And I don't actually think we should jam Chalice for four right now. I don't want to lose to them going like Cryptic your Chalice, bounce Ensnaring Bridge, untap Cryptic again. I guess that's a lot of Cryptics, but I'd kind of just rather pass and then we can Whir end of turn. Oh, we can't Whir end of turn. We can Whir during their upkeep. Or if they tap out now. I guess in that world, I can play a Chalice on one. Does look like they probably have a lot of one drops. Maybe on two is better. Yeah, we'll go for two. That seems pretty reasonable. Shuts out like Abrades, future thing in the ices, etc. Remand. Sure. Flips the other thing in the ice. All right, now I'm going to Whir in response to this opt and get a third bridge. Actually, maybe it should be a maybe it should be a spyglass. No, I think it should just be a bridge. I don't think Jace actually does anything at this point, because we have the Witchbane Orb, so he can't ultimate us. Yeah, all right. We got enough Ensnaring Bridges into play that our opponent decided to throw in the towel. So, definitely want these Spellskites. I think I want Unmortigo just because I'm really curious about what's going on. I'm not sure that I want all the Spellskites also, but I think at least some to start with. Damping Sphere, not so interested. Probably don't need Tormod's Crypt, would rather have Grafdigger's Cage. Can cut Un-EE. Yeah, I'm gonna only bring in like two Spellskites. And I don't know if we need Witchbane Orb. We probably don't. Chalice can probably cover a lot of the Witchbane Orb stuff. And the last cut is probably Tech Edge and Crucible, or just Tech Edge. It looked like our opponent was for sure a Blood Moon deck, almost guaranteed. I want these Tezzerets as well, so we can cut Pyrite Spellbomb. Yeah, they just had so many basic islands, it seemed really, really likely that they were a Blood Moon deck. Anything else? Could cut another EE. Not positive about the two Spyglasses. I would guess they have Jace and maybe have something like Chandra post-board. So I think Spyglass is pretty good to lock those out. I could see going down to just none. Actually, I'm going to cut a Whir. Whir is a pretty weak card against the Blood Moons, and sometimes you get stuck on multiples, so I'll try like this. I really didn't know what was going on, so I'm not sure. Right, here we are for game two. We are on the draw. This hand looks good. Definitely a keeper for me. We can go turn one. I guess we should lead with the jar. Even though I think it's unlikely any of it gets countered or gets removed. I don't think they are probably playing with smelt. This gets all the ones out of our hand, which lets us set up this chalice. Ooh, tough choices. These are both the crucible and the bridge both seem really good, and the spyglass seems potentially really good as well. I think it's just going to be the bridge, though. I would guess our opponent is, you know, still relatively a creature attacking deck, even though it's hard to say for sure. Get this chalice on one going early and often. Figure it's pretty likely whatever we do here gets countered. Sure, that's fine. So then next turn we can play bridge, and then the next turn after that we can fair back the chalice, or ruins back the chalice. Or not, because there's a blood moon coming down. Yeah. Yep. Alright, well, luckily that doesn't actually shut off that much of our deck, because mostly we're all artifacts. Alright. Now we can even play a Whir if we find one. Ooh, okay. This is slightly tricky, but I think we just jam. I should have played a land first in case of mana leak, but I'm really curious to see what's in our opponent's deck. Yeah, I thought that was most likely. That's what I would have named also, for what it's worth. There's the old thing in the ice. Oh no, we're going to get our chalice plucked away, I suspect. Yep. Alright, well, we'll keep playing our lands. We're one away from chalice on four. Which does also have the convenient side effect of potentially locking out Jace. Let's see if this one resolves. Ooh, it did. Lovely. Chalice. I think we can go ahead and chalice on four next turn. We have to spend an opal to do it, but that's not really a big deal. Oh, we don't even have to spend an opal to do it. All right, fingers crossed. No dice. Add another bridge to our hand. I guess we are gonna, I really don't wanna let Vendilion click attack Tezzeret. That seems really silly to have happen. So we are going to spend an opal anyway, because I do want the extra ensnaring bridge, I think. And I'm going to jam another chalice for four next turn. They bottomed with opt. They double bottomed with serum vision. All right, we got our chalice through. We're looking at five artifacts right now, so we got to keep going for a little bit longer. I do want this spyglass. I guess I'm fine using another opal to be able to take it. I Guess I don't even know what I would name with Spyglass at this point because Jace is effectively nixed. So I guess our next step here is Chalice on two or try to win the game with Tezzeret, whichever happens to come first. Chalice on two would stop Hurkle's recall, which seems at this point to be one of the most likely things that beats us. I think we're also going to just actually win the game on our next turn. Because we'll just minus Tezzeret and kill them. Let's see what's going on over there. Oh, okay. Alright, that's one of the things. They get to cycle again with Vendilion Click now as well. I think we should play EE for three. That'll give us out. You know, we can deal with his Blood Moon now. Maybe. I guess they're going to take away our other Ensnaring Bridge, maybe. Let's see who they target with this click. Yeah, they're going to target themselves. That makes a lot of sense. Take away a Dispel. Sure. So we have Double Jar available, so we can, you know, regenerate both of our Ensnaring Bridges before we pop the EE if it comes to that. And we're currently one artifact short by my count. 2, 4, 6, 8. Yeah, so we need one more artifact for Tezzeret to just boom win the game on the spot. That doesn't really count. So we wait. I mean, I guess we could also just minus this turn and or minus next turn and then minus the turn after that. That might just be better. That's funny, they have to cycle Hieroglyph of Illumination because it's actually locked out by Chalice. Love it. Right, there's a Spellskite that'll let us Ultimate Tezzeret for the win. Maybe. Shouldn't have tapped this way. That was bad. But we got there anyway. Alright, well, still never really got to understand what our opponent's deck was up to, but a win's a win. And we'll be back for a round five because I screwed up this video and failed to record the first round, which I won. So we'll be back for round five. All right, here we are for the fifth and final round. This hand looks pretty good. Definitely a keeper. Turn two Chalice, turn three Bridge. Don't know what we're up against. I am playing in the modern two-man queue, which might, you know, be a slightly different sort of metagame. I think I'm just gonna take the opal here actually, because I think getting our hand empty might be important. I don't know. Really don't know what our opponent's up to. It looks like Chalice is probably good. If I had to guess, I would guess a mono red Phoenix kind of deck is the most likely thing. Yeah, that's a Manamorphose for sure. This deck should be incredibly soft to Chalice in game one. We are gonna get smacked for six. And then we play our Chalice. And then next turn we can play Bridge. Are we gonna be able to get our hand empty enough? Because we can play these two, and we still have two lands and a Whir left. So it's gonna be pretty dicey. This might just be too slow. And our opponent can still cast some cards like Skewer the Critics, which definitely could come into play here. If they have that, I think we're gonna lose. If they don't, I think we'll be okay. Play this, play Bridge, and then yeah, next turn we do have Whir for Bottled Cloister. So it's really just if we can fade a burn spell that doesn't cost one. Yeah, that ain't happening. No skewers, please, and thank you. Or Eidolon, I guess. That could also beat us. All right, Manamorphose. I guess if they can make another Phoenix here, we also lose to that. But They'd have to. I guess if they just have one in hand. Oh, Bedlam Reveler. Okay. Discarded some cards that don't do anything. Okay. Light up the stage for the maximum sweat. Oh, I hit the wrong zone. Swiftspear Mountain, no problem. Those don't do anything. Yeah, sure. You can file a monastery Swiftspear directly into your graveyard. I don't mind that. All right, well. Bottled Cloister will keep us safe from attacks. Now we just need to fade. We still have to fade the skewer. But it looks like hopefully our opponent has used up all of their card drawing. And they can enable Spectacle, so we can go Teleria West for an Inventor's Fair, which is a slow way to get a Witchbane Orb into play, but ultimately results in a Witchbane Orb getting into play. So that's probably our plan from here. I guess we also only need to just gain 2 life, and then we're out of burn range as well. Or at least out of range for a while. Oh, actually, yeah, we could also get a chalice and chalice on 3. Yeah, we have a lot of ways to deal with this particular situation. Oh, okay. Well, maybe they don't have Skewer in their deck. That sounds unlikely to me, but I think we were very likely to win there. So, sideboarding. I like Spellskite quite a lot. Do not. Well, Damping Sphere's not horrible. It's not great either, though. Grafdigger's Cage is good. This is a matchup where EE is actually pretty strong because they have the 8-1 drop. The 8-1 drop prowess guys that you want to deal with. Crucible, definitely not necessary. Tech Edge, definitely not necessary. Kind of fine going down to 1 Spyglass. Chandra seems like the most likely thing we would name, and it's probably not anything more than that. Pyrite Spellbomb is actually probably fine. They might board an Eidolon, and they might have other cards that it's, you know. Like, it just kills one of the prowess guys, I guess. That might just be fine. As far as what else to cut, I'm really not sure. I could see cutting one Whir because they're a little bit clunky and a little bit slow. And I want to keep the Witchbane Orb for sure. Maybe we'll cut the Damping Sphere. I don't like this card against normal Phoenix, so it's probably not very good against the red Phoenix either. I guess this way we only have Pyrite Spellbomb in our deck to win the game. So maybe we're supposed to bring in like one Tezzeret or one Psy or something. I'm kind of comfortable just running with just Pyrite Spellbomb and also our opponent conceding as our win conditions. That's fine. We also have Academy Ruins. I guess you can just deck your opponent with Academy Ruins also, unless you end up with the Cloister in play. This hand looks like a pretty easy mulligan to me, not enough land. This hand also doesn't have enough land, but at least has ways to get it. I think we're going to keep Pyrite Spellbomb on top as Eidolon insurance. I should have brought in Unmoored Ego, I think, actually. That was probably a mistake. Relying on just Chalice on 4 to lock that out might not be good enough. I'm going to start by bobbling myself, which will inform if we have to use the other bobble. We don't, because we have a Spire of Industry on top. Plays Pirate, Spellbomb, and pass. And I think we'll go ahead and bobble them. I actually do want to do this because I want to see if we can find an EE. I do want to go ahead and kill one of these, preserve our life total a little bit. And go ahead and pass. I think, again, no need to crack the bobble just yet. Because now we're actually looking at getting our hand a lot lower than... Like we don't want to draw too much stuff because we don't want to have three cards in hand when we play this Ensnaring Bridge. In case of phoenixes. Alright, looks like we're going to two here. I don't love that. Nope, we're dead. Wow. Alright, well, we got a turn three killed on the draw, so not much to be done about that. I am going to bring in these unmoored egos, though, as kind of medium as they seem like they're likely to be. And I think on the draw we can cut Tormod's Crypt and one Spellskite. I'm not confident about either of those cuts, but I really want to make room for this Unmoored Ego because Shatterstorm seems like it could be a problem. Alright, let's give this a try. Okay, here we are for game three. We get to go first. Yeah, this hand looks fine. I think we'll play Teleria West as our first land. It's not that important to not that likely we're going to even have time to transmute it in this matchup. And I want to go ahead and get this stuff down, even though I know turn one Eidolon is super unlikely. They might have Simeon Spirit Guide or something in their deck. Don't want to go fishing for a land just yet. Okay, good to know about an Abrade. I suppose I would regenerate Spellskite if it comes to it. Okay, well, we have we're gonna have Bridge with Spellskite back up, and then also Witchbane Orb coming in pretty soon next turn. Hopefully, that's enough to keep us safe. But this red deck can be extremely explosive. Just a mere 7 damage this turn, it looks like. Oh, wait, no, maybe there's more. No, just 7. Okay. I think that's going to leave us at probably a high enough life total, given that we'll have a Spellskite. Is it even good to play Ensnaring Bridge here? It might just be better to play Witchbane Orb. It uses our mana a little more efficiently. Yeah, I'm gonna just do that. We'd still have 2 cards in hand, so it's not like it's really stopping any of this stuff from attacking us. I'll play the bridge next turn. I am going to go ahead and block here. If we lose our Spellskite to a Bolt, good beats. Yikes. Alright, I think I just go ahead and try and name Shatterstorm. Make sure we don't lose to that. I guess a Braid might also just be a reasonable thing to name. Seems more likely that they have more Abrades. I guess, yeah, I'm going to actually just name Abrade. No, I'm going to name Shatterstorm first. And then we can name Abrade with the second one. Okay, so they don't have any copies of that. Let's see what they do have. Looks like they don't have... Oh, they have a Shattering Spree. Okay, well, Spellskite does actually beat Shattering Spree, so that's fine. Yeah, they have no more Abrades. They have a Lava Spike they can only target themselves with. And an Arclight Phoenix. So getting the bridge into play is actually going to be good. And the rest of these cards don't really do anything. Alright, cool. Good talk. So yeah, we will ultimately be naming Shattering Spree with this Unmoored Ego, but getting the Incinerating Bridge into play is definitely a higher priority. Alright, they ripped a land so they can play the Phoenix. And they get to hit us for a bit of damage. Not too much. I think we just take a land here. Makes it that much more likely we can get to 0 cards next turn. And that really is the dream. Alright, get out of here, Shattering Spree. We don't like you at all. And yeah, I don't see a way we can lose, because we can play every card we can draw, and that'll do it. Might take a little bit, because I don't know if our opponent's going to concede, but I believe we have the check mark at this point. Just get another Ensnaring Bridge down. This might take a little bit, because we are just playing Drago for a while. I suppose eventually we'll be able to transmute a Teleria West for an Academy Ruins, and then turn the Academy Ruins, or then turn something into a into a pirate spell bomb, and that'll do it. So yeah, this is the kind of game that's easy to navigate on Magic Online. These are the kinds of games where you get into trouble in Paper Magic, because it's really hard to force your opponent to play at a pace that lets you finish the game, even when it is zero. They are 0%, and you will win with a chess clock. That's not the way Paper Magic works, so that's definitely something to be aware of here. Like, if I was playing in a tournament, I would actually be pretty aggressive about pressuring my opponent to play quickly. Because it's, you have a responsibility to protect yourself. All right, so we don't want to play this for one, so we'll play it for two. Maybe for, yeah, two is good. We don't want it on one because we don't want to shut out our own, our own pirate spell bomb. Even though we have engineered explosives, so we could eventually, blow it up and go through that whole song and dance. It just sounds complicated, given that we know our opponent can't do anything. I guess there is a world where they could win, where we end up accidentally locking ourselves by playing if our Bottled Cloister comes up in our deck first, and we end up putting it into play. So I should have played Chalice for four, actually, because I really don't want Bottled Cloister in play. That's the only way we can realistically lose. So I'll play this for four. And then we can Welding Jar our Witchbane Orb. Because, yeah, if our Bottled Cloister comes up, then we can end up decking ourselves with Academy Ruins. But if our Bottled Cloister comes up too late or too early in our deck, so we have to play it, and then the Academy Ruins comes up really late in our deck, and or the Pyrite Spell Bomb, such that we can't actually win the race against our own Bottled Cloister. So I guess our opponent wasn't literally 0%. They were just very unlikely. Speak of the devil. They might also concede to Bottled Cloister because then it is apparent they will never get another combat step. They might not realize that this is actually one of our lose conditions, although now I think it's not. I think we don't have enough cards in our library that we could possibly lose because we're just going to find a Welding Jar at some point. And once we do, we can remove the Bottled Cloister from play. I guess I don't even have to play this chalice, but I will. Right, I am correct that I put zero Tezzerets in our deck. Yeah, I am. Okay, well, we're doing this the hard way. Right. Inventor's Fair is step one of the Pyrite Spellbomb game plan. Ooh, and there's the Academy Ruins and the Pyrite Spell Bomb. That's game. Here it is. Let's get this party started. All right, I'm going to turn off the video at this point. We've seen our opponent's entire deck. We know that we have the check mark. Doesn't seem particularly interesting to watch. Kudos to those of you who stuck around for as long as you did. This deck can be a little rough at times, but it's a wild ride. It's fun. And thanks for watching. I'll be back soon. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe if you enjoyed it. And I'll see you later.